All right, we're live on Facebook. Good evening, Facebook, our Discovery Church family. Those of you who are sitting close, you just beware, they're going to see and hear you. Anyway, no, that's not true. They're only going to hear what's going through the soundboard. But anyway, occasionally it does pick up your voice from my microphone, and just beware. Anyway, it's great to see all of you. Look who all is here tonight. Such a big crowd. It's great to have everybody. And Lorna's here after surgery, major surgery last week. What a trooper she is. What a trooper she is. A few things to share with you. Several things, actually, to share with you. First of all, spring ahead, March 12th, which means... That means daylight savings time begins on Sunday the 13th. So... Set your clock ahead, spring ahead, the night before or when you go to bed or something like that. And don't forget to change the battery or batteries in your smoke alarms. It's a good measure about every 6 months to do that, or 4 months or whatever. Anyway, so change your smoke alarm batteries. Celebration Sunday will be the 20th of March, and the theme is Potato Bar. You may have seen it on the announcement scrolling earlier, but Potato Bar, that's in honor, memory, recognition, whatever, of St. Patrick's Day. Since St. Paddy's Day happens in March, the theme will be something Irish, which is the potato bar and all the varieties of fixings. And so those of you who like all that, you'll have a good time. But Church Cleanup Day is Saturday, April 2nd from 9 a.m. until ? Till whenever we finish. Or get tired of it. Depending on what your job is that day, you might be done by 9:30. Who knows? That's also the same day as the Women's Conference at Thalia Lynn Baptist Church. Please see Suzanne Richardson. She has all the information, the flyers, and so on and so forth. The cost is $25 per person, and it is a requirement that you be a woman, since it is a woman's retreat. Not a trans anything, or identifying as a cookie or whatever. So anyway, I figured I'd throw that in just to be sure. I think that's it for the announcements. Particularly for those of you who are tuning in on Facebook Live, thank you for choosing to be with us tonight, virtually speaking, and thank you for choosing Discovery Church as your place to hear the Word and pray and be part of our church family. You may be wondering how you can be a financial partner with Discovery Church. And if you'd go to our website at www.discoverychurchvb.org and click on the Donate tab, you can find all the ways you can give to the Lord through Discovery Church. Those of you who are here tonight, you also have the treasure chest there. Whether you're in person or whether you're attending virtually, we treasure your gifts, and we thank you for choosing Discovery Church as your place to exercise your stewardship. And by the way, particularly those of you who are part of our extended family, on Facebook, if you find value in the Word and the worship and our togetherness, even though it is virtual or digital, and you would like to support this ministry, we certainly would covet your donations and ask you to become a financial contributor and financial partner with us. And thank you again for choosing Discovery Church as your place to exercise and demonstrate your faith. I can't remember if there's a song next, or I think it's prayer request. Yeah, here we go. Those of you who are on Facebook, we want you to tell us what your prayer requests are as well. Understanding that because of privacy laws, you might want to make sure, and it really should be a requirement, that you have the person or person's approval to share their request. And sometimes too much information is too much information. Tell us for whom we can pray, and if they're okay with you telling a little bit about their situation, then we'll be happy to lift that person in the situation before the throne of God. But let us know what your requests are. Throughout our course of our Café worship together, just put them on Facebook, provided you have the approval to do so. And if it's about yourself, just make sure you temper that accordingly. And we're going to enter our time of worship, and we're going to continue to work through the Lord's Prayer. And then afterward, we will have a prayer time specifically for the needs of you on Facebook and the requests that you share, and those of us who are here together tonight. And we have a prayer request sheet floating around somewhere right there. Okay, and so we'll collect that at the very end, and when we'll go through those. But anyway, speaking of prayer, let's start off with prayer tonight. Heavenly Father, thank you for this day, and thank you for blessing us with life and giving to us the privilege and opportunity to be in your house, to fellowship with one another. And some of us are here in person, and some of us are in person virtually on Facebook, but we are still one body in Christ. Thank you that we can meet together, and that we can encourage one another, and we can pray for one another, we can worship with one another, we can study and learn together with one another, and that we might collectively hear from you, God. This is your time. It is your church. Have your will and way. And in a selfish way, God, I pray that you will use me to speak your word and bring about what it is that you would have us to know. And may it be life-changing for us. May it be something that causes us a holy discontentedness that we cannot sit back and be disobedient in any way, but rather that we might be obedient to you in the cause and the call of the gospel to tell others about the hope that is found in Jesus and Jesus alone. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So we're going to start off with the Lord's Prayer. Since we're talking about the Lord's Prayer.
heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory. He gave the cleansing flood. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me and I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plans me to victory.
Is plunge. That's the Greek word baptizo, means to dip, plunge, or submerge. Otherwise, getting wet all over. There's no getting around that. Jesus was in the water, under the water. I neglected to mention this to you. This is of utmost importance. This is our new church directory. It's not complete. You celebrated a little too soon on that one. I need you still to look at your information to make sure it is correct. There are some of you who have yet to look at your information to make sure it is correct. It's not going to get finished until you check. What I would like for you to do is find your name. It's listed in alphabetical order by last name. Well, the first person that didn't put a check by his name is James Addison. So, for the benefit of those of you on Facebook, James Addison said, call him out, those who didn't put a check by the name. You know, there's just a big name by the Addison name, so a big check by the Addison name, so we know that yours is good. But there are quite a few people on here who have not checked their information to make sure it is correct. And unless and until we find out that your information is correct, we're not going to print a directory, because we're not going to print a wrong one only to give it to you and then go, oh, my information's wrong. Because that happens every year. It's right here. I need you to find your name, wherever it is on here, and check every little detail, every dot, every I, every T, every letter in your email address, birthday, so on and so forth. Make sure it's correct. Those of you on Facebook, you find your name on here somewhere and let us know if it needs to be corrected. It's right there. Seriously, those of you who are on Facebook, many of your names are on the directory as well. If you have had a change of any of your information, you may have gotten married and your name has changed, you may have moved, new address, phone number, email address, your birthday didn't change, except for when the day you met Jesus, you got a new, you were born again. But anyway, if any of your information has changed, and particularly your email address, let us know so we can make sure that we have the right information in our database. You messaged Samantha through Facebook. Samantha sent an email out early this morning. It was 8:49, I think it was, when I received it, letting you know of the menu change for tonight. And I understand that some of you didn't get it because your email address is not in her email outreach email account. So the information that you provide to us that goes in our database is what she gets. So if your information is incorrect or it's absent or whatever, we don't have the right information, you're not going to be able to communicate with us, and vice versa. So it is very important. Now that I've beat that dead horse, check your information, make sure it is correct. We are continuing on with the Lord's Prayer. We're in verse 13. I want to read the whole thing for you, even though we just kind of had it in the song. We're going to go back to verse 9. Again, Lord, I'm using the King James Version only. Verse 9, "After this manner, therefore, pray ye, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Well, we're at the last part of the prayer itself. And so the question for tonight is, since we have a question for our Wednesday evening format, what does, "and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil," mean? Verse 13. Well, again, this is the final week in the series, and it's the sixth and final petition of the Lord's Prayer. When you first look at verse 13, and you read the words, "and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil," it sounds like two different things, but it really isn't. It's one petition. In Hebrew, there's rhetoric called parallelism. So there's two petitions in this one verse. "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil." To lead us not and deliver us, those two things actually mean the same thing. Those two phrases mean the same thing. This is, again, it's an age-old form of Hebrew rhetoric called parallelism. You have two phrases put together, one following the other. And even though they're different words, the meanings are the same. And this is, you'll find this throughout the book of Psalms. And here's one example from Psalm 29, verse 5. The voice of the Lord breaketh the cedars. Yea, the Lord breaketh the cedars of Lebanon. Two separate phrases, but they both mean the same thing. Now, this is a very clear example, talking about breaking the cedars, breaking trees. The voice of the Lord is that strong, can break trees. And then it says, "Yea, the Lord breaketh the cedars of Lebanon." Not exactly the same words, but the same meaning. It's for reinforcement. It is really for something to, you know, to take note and say, well, what is God really trying to tell me? What is He trying to reinforce here? Verse 13 in Matthew chapter 6 is really one thought, one concept of deliverance and protection, but written from two separate angles. "And lead us not into temptation." It'll make more sense as we move along. But when you think about temptation and the source of temptation, you'll see the connection between the two phrases. The difficulty really is in the first half of this question. "And lead us not into temptation." This is really a tough phrase when you try to wrap your mind around it, because Jesus is praying to God the Father. He's saying, "Hey, Father, don't lead us into temptation." When you first look at that, and when you ponder that, and then when you look at it through the lens of Scripture, you might be taken aback a little bit. Maybe should. And you might even ask yourself, if we're asking God to not do this, it begs the question, can it even happen? Lead us not into temptation. Does that mean, in fact, that it can happen? Would God intentionally lead us into a temptation of some sort? And you might want to follow up that question by asking another question of yourself. Well, but doesn't God want us to be faithful and obedient? Then why would He lead us into temptation or allow us to be tempted? Shouldn't protection from temptation be a given for Christians? You would think so, right? So then why would Jesus say, and lead us not into temptation. Let us not be tempted by something. Well, James points out, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and He Himself tempts no one. Some of this lies in the difference of the words. To be tempted by something, you have to first want it. You have to first desire it. You have to somehow say, I really need that. And you're subject to falling into whatever the temptation is. Temptation is not the same as testing or proving or trying. God does not tempt us. If it's true that God does not tempt us, why then would Jesus say, and lead us not into temptation? He's praying to God the Father. It's an interesting question, isn't it? Well, looking through the whole of the Bible at this question and temptation and the possibility of God leading us into temptation, we will find in Matthew 4, verse 3, that there is only one being who is called the tempter. And that is the devil himself. In Matthew chapter 4, you may remember that Jesus was in the wilderness, led of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. We know that through Scripture, He fought the devil off. He did not give in to any of his temptations. And God's Word says then that the devil, Satan, is the tempter. He is the one who tempts us. He is the one who, I think I mentioned this past Sunday, who dangles that carrot in front of you. He knows you want the carrot, leading you all along into going after that carrot, or whatever it is, so that you might get caught in something. Ensnared would be a really good word there, as Hebrews, the book of Hebrews, mentions it. We can better understand this verse or grasp this verse in the Lord's Prayer through this paradigm. God does no tempting. It's not His nature, it's not His character, it's not His makeup, it's not how He is or who He is. God does not tempt. But Satan certainly is characterized by it. It is part of his nature and part of his makeup and part of his character and so on and so forth. The devil's job is to tempt you and me into sin. Sin is what? Missing the mark. What's the mark? The perfection of God, obedience to Him and His Word. Satan will tempt us, dangle that carrot, or put something in front of us to distract us all along the way in our walk of faith with the motive and motivation of trying to get you off track. And you know what? Even before you become a Christian, the temptation of the devil is incredibly strong. He tempts people to disbelieve in God. He'll do anything he can to prevent people from coming to faith in Jesus. And by the looks of it, he's doing a pretty good job. He's really good at what he does. And then after you become a Christian, the devil is good at tempting some people to question their faith. Am I really saved? Does God really love me? Well, I did it again. I fell short of His glory. I must not be saved. That's wrong. That's a lie from the devil. So we can better understand this verse if we remember these two things. God does not tempt us, but the devil does. It's not in God's nature or character to tempt, but it certainly is in the devil's nature and character to tempt. And tempting is not testing. Testing or proving is always for the purpose of growing in maturity and faith and trust of God. God will allow us to be tested in order to prove our faith and faithfulness. But test and tempt, two different things. Have you ever been through something that's very testing? A trial? A hardship? Pain, suffering, agony, loss? Sure. Those things are intended to prove, to develop, to strengthen our faith in God. It's not tempting us into sin. And you know what? Those truths right there are incredibly relevant in the Lord's Prayer when you look at the second half of this verse. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. The word evil, or from, the two words from evil in Greek, can and have been translated as the evil one. So you may have a version of the Bible that says deliver us from the evil one, which is very true, very accurate, nothing wrong with that. Some versions of the Bible interpret it that way, and it's incredibly accurate to say. If you're a Bible scholar or a nerd of some kind, in terms of biblical words and study, the phrase that's used here is in the nominative case. It's talking about an individual. And it also comes after a direct article, the. Again, in Greek, it's the evil. Deliver us from the evil. If it's the evil, it certainly is a small step, if it's even a step, to say, therefore, it must be a direct reference to the one who is really evil, the evil one. So there's absolutely nothing wrong with it saying, and deliver us, but deliver us from the evil one, who is the source of all things evil. Perfectly fine, perfectly accurate to say that the devil, the evil one, is being addressed in this second half of this verse. We can also understand Matthew 6:13 through the experience of Jesus when he was tempted. I mentioned it a few minutes ago that when he was in preparation for his earthly ministry, he was fasting for 40 days in the wilderness, and he was led of the Spirit to be in the wilderness, to be tempted of the devil. This was preparing him for his ministry. But in his own story, which you know was just two chapters before Jesus said the Lord's Prayer, we see the same paradigm at work. We see the same thing. God does not tempt, the devil does tempt. It was the devil who went to Jesus in his weakened state after his 40 days of fasting and said, "Hey, don't you want this? Aren't you hungry?" You know what? The Bible says that, or the Word of God says that if you throw yourself down, angels will come and you won't even strike your heel on a stone. Why don't you throw yourself off this mountain here? Or you take him up to the mountain and says, "Hey, Look at this. Look at all this stuff. I'll give this to you. You know what's really important about that? That's right. He didn't say that the devil didn't have the authority to give it to him because he already owned it. The earth is the domain of the devil. The Bible calls him the prince of this world. Satan couldn't offer Jesus something if he didn't have it to give. And we wonder why this world is so full of evil today. It's because the devil, the tempter, does a really good job at what he does. But Jesus fought the devil off with the Word of God. So if God was allowing Jesus to be tempted and Jesus fought the temptation off with the Word of God, it would be God casting out God. That's not possible. But Jesus used the Word of God to fight away the temptations of the devil. And after the third time, what does the Bible say? The devil left. And angels came and tended to Jesus. Through Jesus' own story and his own experience, we can better grasp this verse that says, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Because Jesus in his temptation was delivered from the temptations of the tempter, the evil one, by the Word of God. So it was not God that was allowing, or it was not God who was tempting Jesus. It was the devil who was tempting Jesus, but Jesus fought him off with the Word of God. So the paradigm remains. God does not tempt, Satan does. Now, I don't know about you, but you know, when I look at Jesus' fasting for 40 days, and I guess it depends on what your perspective is on fasting and what it is that Jesus did during these 40 days of being in the wilderness. Imagine you're in the wilderness right now. In the wilderness, there's not a plentiful supply of sustenance, food, water. And you're now in that environment for 40 days. I probably would have failed that test early on. I like to eat. Yeah, we're Baptists, right? But there's no telling what some of us would have done after just 40 hours of fasting. How long has it been before this meal tonight? How long had it been since you ate your previous meal? 4 or 5 hours? Did you start to get a little hungry? After just maybe 2 or 3 hours? Man, I'm ready to eat again. Think of that now for 40 days. It's funny how God works sometimes, because next week, the season of Lent begins. Are you familiar with the season of Lent? Yeah. Or the Lenten season? The Lenten season is often characterized by fasting. Most Baptist churches ignore that, maybe for obvious reasons. What'd you say? They're slow. They fast fast. Yeah, okay. And you're going to hear more about it over the coming weeks, because I think the Lenten season is something we can learn from and through. And you might be challenged during the Lenten season to fast this year. Now, if you're definition of fasting is depriving yourself of all things food and water, that's not what a fast is. There are different varieties and different degrees of fasting. I know Tom fasted every day. He didn't eat breakfast in the morning. To me, that's the most important meal of the day. Because, you know, I get up and I start shaking real quick. I'm like, my blood sugar's dropping. I need to eat. Love breakfast. But there are different degrees and different lengths and periods and purposes behind fasting. Some people say, well, I'm going to give up chocolate for the season of Lent. Some people say, I'm going to give up a particular habit for the season of Lent. Sugar, or I'm going to give up something, or behavior. I'm going to stop cursing, or I'm going to stop eating fast food, or whatever it is. Lent is the 40 days leading up to the resurrection. Again, more about that. But just to prepare you, since we're talking about fasting and temptation, if you're fasting, you may be a little more tempted to cheat on your fast. And a fast is you have committed and or dedicated yourself to abstain from something for a period of 40 days. And this whatever it is that you're abstaining from is almost always, if not always, for the purpose of helping you grow closer to God in your walk of faith. Oftentimes, whatever it is that you give up during the season of Lent is something you now, from that point forward, realize, you know what, I can live without this. And it's gone from that point forward. Habit, behavior, lifestyle, particular kind of food that you know is bad for you, or whatever the case may be. Again, more about that later on. But maybe not just because we're Baptists, but just because we're human beings, we might have difficulty fasting the way that Jesus did during his 40 days in the wilderness. But this is encouraging when we look at Matthew 6:13, when Jesus said, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil or the evil one," it's encouraging to think that the Son of God, having recently accomplished a monumental feat of obedience through fasting, he is giving us permission here in the Lord's Prayer to ask God not to lead us into temptation. Father, I'm in this season. I'm avoiding, I'm abstaining from something so that I can draw closer to you. God, protect me from the temptation that I might experience during this time so that I might not fail in my commitment. It sounds like at least partially Jesus is telling you and me that we have permission to go to God and say, God, prevent me from being tempted. God wants us to be obedient to Him. He wants us to be faithful to Him. He wants us to succeed in our commitment and dedication to Him. So it makes good sense that Jesus would have experienced and set an example and then reinforced it here in prayer when he says, "And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one." Well, Jesus' actual prayer stops at the words, "Deliver us from evil." That's where his prayer ends. Now, I know the rest of the verse goes on to say, "For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen." We'll get to that at some point in the future. Those words are not actually part of his prayer. Again, we'll get to that. But it might leave us wondering why. Why? He didn't even end his prayer there with amen. That comes after the kingdom and the power and the so on forever and ever. Amen. Jesus' petitions in the prayer for us and the example and the encouragement for us to pray in this particular way ended with just, "And deliver us from evil." And, you know, perhaps it's because, I've already mentioned all those things, perhaps it's because we're meant to continue praying in our own words. You know, a lot of people, when we first started this series, a lot of people in a lot of different kinds of churches look at the Lord's Prayer as this is the prologue. This is where you begin every prayer. Every time you come before God, start off with, "Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name," etc., etc. Pray all these things and then get to what it is that your heart really wants to talk to with God about. That's not necessarily true, but it could be. And so perhaps we're meant to pray this prayer and then get to the point where, all right, it's now our own words. What do we want to say? But there are also six petitions in the Lord's Prayer, and we've examined every one of them over the last several weeks. This could point to some kind of Sabbath motif. You know, 6 days and a rest? Six petitions and a rest? Or six petitions of talking or saying something to God, and then it's all of a sudden, be still and know God. Psalm 46:10. Say all these things and then wait for God to speak. Or wait for God to respond. Wait for God to direct or answer a question. Wait for God. Be still and know that I am God, Psalm 46:10 says. Maybe that's what Jesus was getting at. I don't know. No one knows. There are so many theories behind the Lord's Prayer. What did Jesus mean when he said these things? Why did he say this? Why did he say that? Why did he say it in this particular order? Why did his prayer or his petitions within the prayer stop at "deliver us from the evil one"? Perhaps it could be for all those reasons, or it could be for some other unknown reason. It could be for reasons that we don't know of. But it may be that Jesus wants us to listen for God to speak, or direct, or something else. We know that prayer is talking with God. Prayer is not, "God, I need, God, I want, God, I gotta have, God, blah, 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 and then bye." Prayer, it involves three things, really. And I want to encourage you, if you do a daily devotion, maybe try something like this. Or maybe before you even go to God in prayer, maybe try doing this. I'll demonstrate. Three things. Number one, get your Bible out. Sit it on your lap. And put your hands like this. This is a position of submission. It is acknowledging the holiness of God and His Word. And you do this when you start your devotion, or you do this when you start your reading, palms down. God, I just want to soak in Your Word right now. When you've done with your devotion or done with your Bible reading, turn your hands over. You're receiving. God, I receive Your Word right now. And I thank You for Your Word. And then when you're done, you lift your hands in praise. God, thank You for Your Word. Show me, tell me what You want me to know. What You want me to do. God, I praise You for the holiness of You and the holiness of Your Word. Hallowed be Thy name. Thank You, God. Submission, reception, celebration. Maybe approach devotion and prayer and reading of the Word of God in that kind of way. And see what He does. Listen for what He might say. Be willing to follow where it is He might direct. And just see what might happen in your life from that point forward. Maybe Jesus was intending to lead us to some point like that. I don't know. But I do know this. The more you revere the Word of God, the more you read the Word of God, the more He'll speak to you. And the more He will lead you and guide you to be faithful and trusting of Him. And certainly when you get to the point and make it personal, And lead me not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Deliver me from evil. Closing with Kristen's favorite version of this song tonight. Good night, everyone. It's great to see you. Thanks for tuning in on Facebook Live. Again, if you have a request, a prayer request, go ahead and send them to us now if you haven't done so already. We're going to enter into a time of prayer here, and because you can't hear everyone praying, just know that we're praying for you tonight, and please pray for us. Until next time, God bless you.